She's got long legs and short shorts, but she ain't got no teeth. She wears a red bandana on her head, and she smiles so, so sweet. She'll steal your heart, and if the shaft should rip apart your soul, she'll torture your mind and waste your time and drag you down the road. 'Cause she's a Jezebel, St. Andrew Jezebel. 'Cause she's a Jezebel, St. Andrew Jezebel.
Well, hey, y'all. Is this rain ever gonna stop? Who's been doing the rain dance? I feel like if it keeps raining, I just might have to figure out how to build an ark. So thank you again for tuning into the St. Andrew's Jezebel podcast. If this is your first time listening, welcome. My name's Ashley Feller, and my family has lived in various parts of Bay County since at least the 1920s, and I'm also a working singer-songwriter and musician. I grew up in historic St. Andrews, and that's what this podcast is all about. There's so many great things happening this week, y'all, and I'm so excited to be the one that's sharing them with you. This week, we'll be talking about the week of July 22nd through the 28th, and then after that, I'm really happy to welcome Lois Carter to the podcast. She's been involved with Kaleidoscope Theater since their second season, which was in the 1970s, and she's also a dedicated supporter of the arts in St. Andrews. After that, we've got a pretty funny article that I think you're going to get a kick out of. I found it in the St. Andrews Bay News, and it was published July 24th in 1923. Well, I hope y'all came thirsty, because you know I am. I'm always thirsty. What kind of beer y'all been drinking? If you're listening on YouTube, let me know in the comments. Okay, y'all, crack open your beers, grab yourself a snow cone, maybe a beer snow cone. Whatever you got, get it and enjoy the show. Y'all ready? I hope so, because I've got a shit ton of things to share with y'all that are happening right here in St. Andrews this week. So let's start on Thursday, July 22nd. There is an open mic at the Library on Beck starting at 7, and it's hosted by my dear friend Lynn Baker and Woody Jenkins. If y'all attend, you're welcome to play covers or originals, and the library is a really neat little bar. They've got books everywhere, and they've also got a sweet little selection of craft beer. Then, Friday at 1 p.m., meet Ellen at the Panama City Publishing Museum for the historic walking tour. This is a really wonderful activity to do with your family. It's leisurely walking, and you'll learn a lot about historic St. Andrews. There's also a printing exhibit which features master printer Buddy West and fellow printers Bonnie Blue, Celeste Hansel, Deborah Kivett, Robbie Fehrenbach, Shirley Howell, and more. This exhibit is only up in July, and it goes on from Tuesdays through Fridays from 1 to 5:30 and Saturdays from 9 to 1. Then later, after the walking tour, I would guess sometime around sunset, the Panama City Quality of Life presents Movies in the Bark at Oaks by the Bay Park, and this week they are showing A Dog's Purpose. Now, for my friends who are into jazz, make sure you go to the library this Friday night at 8 p.m. to see the Jazz Masters. They've got Joe Fucci and Luke Penninger, and they are two of my most favorite musicians in this whole area. Tell them Ashley said hi. I think you'll have a really great time if you choose to spend your Friday night at the library. For all you early birds out there, the market at St. Andrews is every Saturday in the lot next to the shrimp boat, and it opens at 8 a.m. There are so many fantastic arts and crafts vendors. There's food trucks, and there's live music brought to you by Floriopolis, and that begins at 10 a.m., and this week, look out, they got Casey Phelps. She is awesome. She is one of the best musicians in this whole area. She has been instrumental in the music scene, and she's been especially influential to me. So go show Casey some love at the market at St. Andrews this Saturday. If you're like me and you're in desperate need of a margarita, which is often, then I suggest this Saturday night you go to Los Anahitos and check out Jamal Terry. He plays a huge variety of music. He plays guitar. He plays saxophone. He's one of the most versatile musicians in this area, and he's playing from 6 to 9. Not to mention, they have a delicious menu. They have a gorgeous patio that overlooks Lake Ware. It's one of the most beautiful spots to be at in historic St. Andrews, hands down. Another choice for your Saturday evening would be to go see the lovely Kelsey Iman at Little Village, and she starts playing at 6 to 9. You could get some tacos from Finn's, you could do a little shopping, you could relax under the palapa. Little Village is a wonderful place to unwind on Saturday evening and enjoy a wonderful dining experience with your friends. So, it's now Sunday. What are you doing for brunch? I recommend you go to Alice's on Bayview. I think their brunch starts at 10:30, and they have some of the best shrimp and grits. It's almost as good as my mom's, and my mom's is pretty damn good. They also have great Bloody Marys, and they have music. Or if you like to sleep in on Sunday, you could also go to Little Village. Casey's open mic is happening at 2 p.m., so bring your friends, bring your songs, drink you some beers, eat you some tacos, and have a great time with Casey and friends from 2 to 5. How do you usually spend your Mondays? I usually don't go out a whole lot, but if I did, I would go to the Monday Night Little Fest at the Tap Room. This is hosted by Kirk and Cheyenne, and it's a showcase of a variety of different singer-songwriters throughout the Bay County area, and there's also a multitude of delicious beers on tap. You'll love it. Are you one of those people who likes to dance like nobody's watching, or do you like a little bit more structure? So every Tuesday, there's line dancing with Janine at the House of Bourbon, and they start at 7. This Wednesday, I encourage you to come by Floriopolis for public art hours starting at noon. They supply the canvas and paint, and you can create your own piece for their Art in Public Spaces exhibit, which is on James Fence just down the road. The upcoming theme is boats and water, but right now you can check out the paintings of reptiles and amphibians painted by the volunteer artists. They are Silas Dyer, Kelly Dyer, Jared Wampler, J.A. Robinson, Heather Parker, Jim Hayton, Maverick Knowlton, Krista Eggleston, and more. All of us at Floriopolis would like to thank our generous sponsors, Brad Stevens, Crystal Overend, Ellen Mapleston, Pat Neese, and Denise Nyland. By Wednesday, I'm sure we're all going to need some laughs. So I suggest you visit the library on Beck for a comedy open mic, which is hosted by Panama City Comedy. I believe sign up is at 7:30. And the open mic is from 8 to 10 p.m. That's all I got for this week for the community events. Make sure you tune in next week for more.
One of the best things about St. Andrews is that you can see live music every day. That's right. There is live music being played somewhere in St. Andrews 7 nights a week. Fortunately, my friend Ken Schaefer creates and publishes a weekly schedule for St. Andrews as well as most of Bay County. Ken's spreadsheet schedule is updated often when there's any changes. Ken also shares individual music events and is walking the walk and talking the talk when it comes to supporting live music. Not only does Ken supply the music schedules, but he attends several music performances a week and takes fantastic photos of the musicians. As a working musician myself, I feel blessed to have Ken and his wife Donna as treasured members of our local musical family. Make sure you like and follow Ken's page, Salty Sounds in St. Andrews, and Oh Boy Music on Facebook, so that you'll always know where all the live music will happen. Thank you so much, Ken, for everything you do.
Lois Carter was born at the corncob pipe capital of the world, also known as Washington, Missouri. After marrying, she and her family moved to Florida, where she earned her first degree in electronics technology and also taught technology and computer programming at Gulf Coast Community College, which is now known as Gulf Coast State College. This led to earning another degree in social studies at Florida State University. Lois has been involved with Kaleidoscope Theater since its second season in the early 1970s. She's passionate about performing, community, and volunteerism. She shares her life with her husband, who is also an educator and is the mother of 2 children and 2 stepchildren. For those who know Lois, they'll tell you that she is the ultimate cheerleader. She might not do flips anymore, but she's locally famous for her splits.
Good morning, Lois. Thank you for being on the St. Andrews Jezebel podcast this morning. Kaleidoscope Theater has been around since 1970. And when did you begin your involvement there?
It had to have been very early. I believe it was 1972. Maybe 71. We don't even know for sure. But from the very beginning, I've been there. I've had children since then. I've been on stage with harmony in my belly. I've been with them almost from the very beginning. I think there was one season that I missed and then I joined.
That's amazing. That's awesome. And so how'd you find yourself in the theater industry?
Well, I was working as a clerk at the News Herald, and the receptionist came up to me and said, "We need someone who will be brave enough to sit on a table and sing off key for a play. And you're the first person I thought of." And I went, "Of course I will." So I auditioned for Cherie in the play Bus Stop, the Marilyn Monroe part. I was not quite as glamorous, but it was such fun. And I fell so in love with it that I just stuck around.
And was that your first role ever? Had you acted before?
Oh, I'd done things in school. Not college, but in grade school, upper elementary and high school. I always enjoyed performing.
For our listeners who might not be aware, the Kaleidoscope Theater building was destroyed in 2018 by Hurricane Michael. What's the state of the theater now, and how are y'all functioning without a building at the moment?
Poorly. We did lose our building, and we contracted with a local contractor, and we had significant insurance. So we really felt that we would be back on our feet early, say within a year at the most. But as most people who went through Michael understand, what you anticipate and what actually occurs do not match. So we had some major difficulties with communication with our contractor. And since most of the board members were busy with their own homes, we just ignored it and just said, "Do what you need to do because we trust you." And they did. Well, now we have quite an expense. It was our fault for not monitoring it, but I think those who went through Michael understand that you were busy doing something else. So we had a few people, one or two, who volunteered to be the communication, but they were not builders. They were actors. We believe in magic. I don't know why this contractor didn't believe in magic. What does he mean we need money? So major misunderstandings about the cost of things and who was covering it has left us with an unfinished building. And currently, we need $300,000 to just finish the building, plus any previously charged things that we essentially owe the contractor, but I feel we can negotiate, and we just need to open the building and start doing what we do. What we do is perform. And we involve the whole community. Everyone there is a volunteer. We run a business with volunteers. We run a theater with volunteers. The directors, the tech people, the backstage people, the actors, everyone's a volunteer. And that's the heart of Kaleidoscope, that we involve everyone that we can. People just walk in and say, "I've always wanted to do blah, blah, blah." And we say, "Give it a shot." And it's a family. It's a family. And we are undergoing a major fundraising campaign. We just got a new board, so we're holding off until we elect new officers and get our ducks in a row for that. But pay attention, everyone. I'm going to talk to you. We have a building fund account. And I don't know if you are aware, but the founder of Kaleidoscope was Charles Wilson. He founded it back in the early 70s. It was his theater, and he and his wife truly were the heart and soul of the theater. He died January 1st of this year. So we established the Charles Wilson Memorial Building Fund in his name, and we're so sad that he did not get to see the finished product because he had designed the new buildings. And though they aren't really exactly as he had designed, we couldn't have even gotten started if he had not already drawn out the plans. So yes, we have this building fund, and what I'm working on are appealing to older residents who have IRAs or stocks that have accumulated value. And if you have an IRA, you're required to take a distribution each year, and that's taxable. But if you give the distribution to a nonprofit, you pay no tax penalty, and you can take what you want. Well, you have to take a certain amount, but you may take more. So I was just trying to get large amounts, because doing a bake sale and making $25 is not going to get our doors open. So what I had initially established was that folks take their required minimum distribution and of $10,000, or of giving us $10,000 in stock, or writing a check for $10,000, which is a little more difficult, which sounds bold. But even for someone like me, my husband was an instructor, and I pretty much worked as a volunteer. But we could take that money, because we're not living off of that. Our children can support themselves. So you may reach me personally at loisjcarter45@gmail.com, or go to our webpage, kt-online.org, or find any member of Kaleidoscope who will direct you to how this works, and I can inform you. But we also are doing projects, but we haven't established those yet because, like I said, we just elected a new board. So there are new members. We need to readjust with who we have right now.
Well, I think that's a very clever way of funding that repair. You're coming to the end of your 49th season. Are there any productions or big things happening? We'd like to hear about that, as well as what's coming up in your 50th season.
Well, all of that really depends on getting the building open. We did 4 plays for our 49th, and we did 1 at Mosley and 3 at Rutherford, and essentially lost money doing them. Our patrons say, well, we'll come when you're in your theater. Well, that didn't help fund the plays and anything that we needed to work toward the building. So I think until we have the building open, we will do very little outside. It costs too much, and we have big hopes. We're even thinking of possibly, depending upon how quickly we can get the building done, a musical review in November, and it has to be a specific weekend because it's a donation from MTI Music Theater International. They let us use the songs for free. I don't know if we'll have our building done by then, but we want it to be a big, grand opening, wonderful celebration. And that's the big thing right now. And as play selection committee meets, we want to produce wonderful plays again that appeal to all types of audiences, young, old, in between, and those who like edgy and those who like farce and just simple comedy or drama. So that's always been our purpose, and that's what I hope we're going to shine golden in our golden anniversary.
I have hope and faith that you will, because prior to the storm, I believe Kaleidoscope Theater always delivered in those aspects. I've got many fond memories of seeing several productions there that I'll keep with me forever. I hear that you guys had a summer kids camp not too long ago. Can you tell us about that?
I can. It's my baby. It's my baby. This is my 17th year of doing a kids camp. It's only 1 week. And it's very different from other kids camps in that most camps in drama do a play. You come, you audition, you practice the play. And when the week is up, or the 2 week, or whatever event time you have is finished, you've done a production. And I don't know anyone who does one like ours, though there may be. We take 48 kids, divide them into 4 groups of 12 by age, and each group puts on a 15 to 20 minute play or skit that's usually written by us, unless we can find some kind of story that is in selected playbooks. They also do a Broadway musical number. And during the day, they have 3 hours that they spend with their play director and with their musical director. And the other 2 hours, they have what we call a classes. And we have people from all over the community come and volunteer. Jason Hedden from the college did an auditioning. David Bulger from Zen Garden did juggling and all this wild movement and stuff. Pat Neese from the Storytellers does a storytelling class. AJ Paulitis did a theater games and improv. There was Mike Barber and Amy Fogarty, and we have a kitchen staff. I have a staff of 27 people who volunteer for an entire week. It's so rewarding. The kids do marvelous productions. I give scholarships to those who can't afford it, but it's mainly a fundraiser for us and a way to introduce younger people to theater.
I understand Floriopolis had some involvement recently.
Oh my gosh, thank you.
What did Floriopolis do?
They were there 3 days out of the week. This was the second year I've involved them, and that's the best class. Heather and several others, Kelly and Noel, all came, and they did art projects, of course, and they would talk to the students and say, well, what's your play? And to the directors, and they made props and costumes. They made a giant hat for Scrooge. They made rocks. They made swords. They made a soundboard and a light board. These absolutely amazing projects. And it gives the kids the sense of making your own things and that you don't just walk on stage and do your role. A whole lot more goes into it. I miss Floriopolis because it wasn't like an individual, but they are a vital part of camp now, and the kids love them, and the directors love them, and I love them, of course. So yes, it was such a wonderful addition to camp.
I've got to hear some fun things that happen there. We have public hours here every Wednesday, and I'm usually here editing the podcast, and I get to hear about the fun aftermath. And is there a place online that parents and students can refer to find out about next year's kids camp?
Not yet.
Okay.
Eventually, it will be at kt-online.org, which is our website. But I really don't even start planning until March. And this year, I didn't have a venue, and we used Highland Park Elementary School. So, and I didn't have an okay for that from them until May 1st. And I usually start in March, and my deadline for signing up is May 1st.
Oh my goodness.
So we hustled to get all the workers and all the foods and the t-shirts and the everything that goes into it, which that's my job. Once we open, essentially, I don't have a job other than to make sure that everybody's doing well. And if there's someone absent or needs some help, I take over their class. And then, of course, the end of camp during the performance, or rather, to know that camp is over is when the old lady does the splits.
I saw that photo. That's I did a double take. I said, did she really do that? That's amazing. Oh my goodness. So what do you love about St. Andrews? I see you over here pretty often.
I do totally love St. Andrews. And I got involved in St. Andrews when Floriopolis first opened because I was a volunteer there. Like I said, I'm kind of a professional volunteer. And I just fell in love with the whole concept of what Floriopolis was. And Heather is a personality that I just was attracted to in that she's the most creative thinker. She just doesn't think inside the box. For Heather, there is no box. And though I'm not a visual artist, I love art and I love creativity. So I would work at least 2 different days during the week, and I would sell the art, and I would also act as the Chamber of Commerce person because I kind of know a lot of things that are going on, and I loved it so much. And then I was here that I met everyone else in the community. you just walk up and down the street and meet people. It's a unique, lovely, homey place. And I truly love that. And I now love all the great places to eat and to drink and to hear music. I'm not much of a going out at night person anymore, but if I want to, I can find entertainment here. And I love the food, and I love the people who own these places. They just have a great energy. So, oh, and gosh, the pretty museum and the Indian museum and the park. It just has so much to offer. And it feels like a home to everyone.
So if you had some friends who were coming to visit from out of town, where would you recommend them to go out for lunch and then spend their afternoon?
Well, St. Andrews, of course. On Tuesday, be sure to go to Little Village and get tacos on Tuesday for Taco Tuesday. We're at South Price, but don't tell anyone. So, and then you can sit out on the deck and you can watch the water, or you can sit across the street over at Los Antojitos. For me, the ambiance of a restaurant is much more important than the food. Well, not much more, but I love sitting on the water and having my lunch. And then, of course, if you're at Little Village, I guess it's really Finn's where you eat, but Little Village then has such quaint shopping. And then you could come down here for the little dress shops and wonderful sun jammers and the printing museum and the Indian museum. So I've had lots of friends come down, and this is the first stop I have, but I will have to admit, they usually stay at the beach.
You mentioned earlier the volunteers. Is Kaleidoscope Theater looking for any more volunteers? And if so, how could someone who's thinking, I might like to help Kaleidoscope, how would they get in touch with y'all to find out what they need to do next?
Well, again, you can go to kt-online.org and contact us, send us an email. Or we really aren't looking for volunteers other than fundraisers right now, because we have no jobs for them to do. But eventually, that will be a great need, because we love people to help with costuming and backstage and set moving and, well, acting. It will be a while. Once we open the theater, then please come help and have a wonderful time and live that magic that has always been Kaleidoscope Theater.
Absolutely. I look forward to that. What's something that you wish the public knew about the life of a creative that they might not be aware of?
That it's harder than it looks. It takes great effort to do wonderful shows. It takes great effort to do terrible shows. So when you come and go, oh, well, that person was terrible. No, that person got up there and did their best. And how did they create that image or that piece of prop, or who moved all that furniture? How did they do this? People do not realize we have auditions 6 weeks to 8 weeks prior to a show. They have to rehearse almost every night, 3 to 4 nights a week for 6 to 8 weeks. And then you have the tech people who also have to be involved, or people who may make costumes or build set. A lot of work goes into that. And for me, when I see any creative, a storyteller, a singer, a songwriter, an artist, I am blown away by their talent and their ability to stand up and say, this is me. And I think the greatest thing that a person can be is a cheerleader.
Amen to that. We certainly believe in that here at Floriopolis. We use that term often. And I believe it's referred to you. So one more time, how can folks find you or Kaleidoscope online or beyond?
Well, my personal email is loisjcarter45@gmail.com. So you can email me anytime, and I guarantee I will answer you. And Kaleidoscope's website is kt-online.org, and we'll get a response to you. And Facebook, we're always on Facebook, so like us on Facebook and you'll see what's going on. That's probably one of the best ways to do it.
Lois, it's been a delight having you today, and I have faith and hope that Kaleidoscope is going to come back and things are going to be great, and y'all are going to be able to recreate the magic you guys always have been and introduce new magic as well. Again, thank you so much for taking your time to be here today, and until then, keep St. Andrews salty.
When's the last time you had your organ adjusted? Do you need your piano tuned? Just kidding. This week's old news segment comes from the St. Andrews Bay News, and it was published July 24th in 1923, and it was written by Joseph Leaps. Musical Notes by Professor Joseph Leaps. Attune your soul with the infinite. Then have your piano thoroughly tuned and regulated, or your organ cleaned and adjusted by a skilled and conscientious artisan. The musical instrument is a delicate structure and needs wholesome attention 2 or 3 times each year, just as the modern home needs an occasional sanitary renewal. C.D. Knowles of West End and Mr. Hightower of the Sellers Terpene Still have had their pianos tuned and regulated by Professor Leaps, who's been engaged at times for more than a quarter of a century in tuning, regulating, and repairing of pianos and organs in several states. For several years, his whole time was devoted to this line of work in states of Tennessee and Virginia. At one time, he walked from his historical town of Manassas Junction to the battlefield of Bull Run, noting the old bullet holes in the old buildings and trees, and then on foot through a section of country where piano tuners seldom passed, 30 miles to Washington City, finding numerous old square pianos from 50 to 100 years old. Professor Leaps frequently had to whittle out hammers and other parts to make these musical relics usable. He left Manassas with 50 cents and reached Washington with his pockets bulging with Uncle Sam's coin. Besides having a royal time conversing with sturdy farming people, on the way he tarried at Fairfax Courthouse and had the pleasure of seeing George Washington's will written in his own beautiful handwriting. So I'd like to say thank you to everyone who's been following and sharing the podcast with all their salty friends. If you haven't followed us yet, then please do. Make sure you check out our new YouTube series. It's called Salty Field Recordings, and it features videos showcasing several local artists. There's a brand new video posted today featuring our friend Chase Pospischel. Make sure you click the link in the description so you can receive a notification when the new videos are posted on YouTube. And it would be great if you subscribed as well and also shared the video with your salty friends. If you like the theme song, it was written by me and it was recorded by Dave Schwartz at Boundless Sounds on the campus of Gulf Coast State College. The show was recorded by me in my music room. Till next time. Keep St. Andrews salty.
Red lipstick, so thick, and a push-up bra. Tramp stamp, stretch marks, and a lacy thong. Cause she's a Jezebel, St. Andrew Jezebel. Cause she's a Jezebel, St. Andrew Jezebel.